thank you very much for coming and joining us in what is in the latest in a series of symposia this year, my freshman year, under the theme of crossing boundaries and transforming lives. This particular event today, it's more than just a panel discussion or a symposium. It's a day-long event that brings together students, staff, and faculty. It contains demonstrations and experiential offerings where we can learn more about health and well-being in general, not only just for ourselves individually, but collectively for our community, both our CMU community and the community at large. As you know, since I arrived here in July, I've had the pleasure and the good fortune to walk around campus, meet a number of people. The days I spend here, I try to find some time every day to go talk to somebody to learn about different perspectives about CMU, its past, its present, and also especially its future, from different folks with very different perspectives. When I'm on travel, I try to do the same thing, especially exploiting the benefit of people who have been through this campus at different points in time in the history of CMU, people I've met who spanned almost four generations. And that gives a unique vantage point. As you know, also from my email to the community last fall, and more recently, a week or two ago, that among the many themes that have surfaced from my listening tour, one of the topics that have come through loud and clear from many different people, those who are here and those who were here but who live elsewhere, who have been through the CMU campus at one point in their lives, is what I broadly call quality of life. Especially at a time when technology provides us all the intended benefits to enhance and improve our lives, as with any invention or any discovery or any product that's being created through science, engineering, technology, innovation, creativity, etc., there is also a series of unintended consequences, whether it's mobile devices making your life easy and giving you access all the time, but it's very hard to disengage from them, either because we are addicted to them or because we cannot separate ourselves because people expect you to respond as quickly as they send you a message. So that's the flip side of every intended consequence. So given that, quality of life on campus, at least what I've heard from many of you, means very different things to different people. For some students, it may mean the level of stress that goes up around the time of exam. For others, it could be a continuous spectrum where every homework or every requirement puts a challenge. For others, for staff members, it could be career life balance initiative. For faculty, it could be a mixture of all of these. So these are things that don't have a simple solution, that they don't have one solution, but they have a collection of things that are seemingly small, seemingly trivial, but cumulatively have a huge impact. The tone that a leader of a department or a leader of a unit on campus, a staff leader or a faculty leader sets, perhaps not expecting somebody to respond on Christmas Day, et cetera, can have a huge impact on the morale of those who work in that unit. Another way to think about it is also space has a way of creating an ambiance and a mood in addition to intellectual issues. For example, some parts of our campus are almost 100 years old, and it'll require a lot of resources to fix them, to bring them to a place that we would like to be because they were built decades and decades ago. But we also have opportunities to build other things in the future where we can look into the human experience, the living space, as a way to improve quality of life. The university center will soon undergo renovations that will make it possible to do that for students and staff and everybody on campus. The next few buildings we build on campus, let's keep that in mind, how it can improve quality of life. So these are some of the things that have been on my mind. Today we have assembled a group of distinguished faculty and a distinguished visitor who will talk about different aspects of this issue of health and well-being from very different perspectives. We have four faculty members who will be introduced shortly, and they will provide different perspectives from their extensive experience in research and education on the CMU campus, and also in some cases, national policies. I also want to welcome and thank Dr. Karen Hacker, who is the newly appointed director of the Allegheny County Health Department, who, like my wife Mary and me, has recently moved here from the state of Massachusetts. So the population of Massachusetts has gone down by at least three. And the population of Pennsylvania has gone up by three. The moderator for this session will be Mary Suresh, who happens to share her last name with me. And she's been a source of inspiration on the topic of health and well-being in our household for the last 28 years of our being married. Mary's professional background is also in healthcare and public health, and her understanding of health and wellness has given her the passion for this topic as well. This has been a topic that our colleagues at CMU have been talking about more strongly, perhaps, than ever before in the past 12 months or so. And through leadership from a number of entities on campus, the University Health Services, led by Dr. Anita Barkin, the Dean of Students Office, led by Gina Casalina, and also the Associate Provost for Education, Dr. Amy Burkett. They have put their thoughts and efforts and insights into creating this opportunity for the campus. I very much hope that this will be not just a one-off event, but this will be a continuing conversation where we will not only talk about issues, but also take seemingly simple steps and major steps. Some will require resources, some don't require any resources, as we move forward with improving the quality of life for all of us on campus. With that, I would like to introduce Mary and ask her to give her comments and introduce the panel. Thank you.
Thank you, Subra. Good afternoon, everybody. It's really wonderful to see a full house. Thank you so much for coming today. I also want to echo what Subra said, thanking Anita Barkin, Amy Burkert, and Gina Casalegno, also Paula Martin from University Health Services, and I have a host of other acknowledgments to make later. But I think the vision of this program is today we're seeing in reality. It makes us all very, very pleased. So thank you. I'll make some brief remarks. Our activities today are designed to jumpstart and energize our thinking and learning about health and wellness, and how we as individuals, as a campus, and as a community make choices about our lives and our well-being. Subra mentioned that we'll be hearing from four faculty members today. In the interest of time, I will provide some introduction to them a little later. Basically, the work of all of our panelists today uncovers the links between behavior and health outcomes, and how our internal and external environments affect our health. I think the title of our symposium really sums this up and explains the common linkage between what all of our panelists have to say today. Just a couple of things I wanted to mention that we want to ensure that all of our panelists have enough time. And we have distributed index cards to everyone who would be interested in submitting a question. And you can please write down your question and get your card, pass it to the end of the rows, and there are numerous people around, there's Catherine, to submit your question to as well. And moving on, I wanted to introduce our guest today, Dr. Karen Hacker. Karen, as Subra said, is now the director of the Allegheny County Health Department, newly arrived in September from Massachusetts. She has already made an impact on our community, and we'll talk about some of her innovative initiatives. She shares the CMU focus on research. She was the executive director of the Institute for Community Health in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and a member of the faculty of Harvard Medical School and the School of Public Health. Among Dr. Hacker's areas of expertise are healthcare access and delivery and adolescent risk behavior and resiliency. I will add that Dr. Hacker needs to leave at 1 o'clock, so I do want to quickly get her to the podium. We're very grateful, Karen, that you were able to share your time today. I know it's you have a very tightly scheduled day, and we look forward to continuing the conversation and interactions with you. So without further delay, I'll introduce Dr. Karen Hacker.
Am I doing this right? Yes, good. Okay. Well, first of all, I really want to thank Mary for inviting me and the president for having me and all the faculty members and students that I was able to meet at lunch. And I think one of the most important things in working in a health department is having access to fabulous collaborators, because there is no way that any health department in this country at this point in time will have the resources it needs to address the problems without excellent partners. And I think one of the things that attracted me to the Pittsburgh area is that we have a wealth of excellent partners, both in our universities and in our healthcare systems. My job now that I'm out of academia and back in practice is figuring out how to incorporate that into the work that we do. As I mentioned earlier to one of the folks at the luncheon, I've always said that I'm not really interested in research for research's sake. I'm interested in research that is going to help us drive the agenda. In my prior life, I've spent a lot of time doing something called community-based participatory research. I'm not sure if folks know about that, but one of the big pieces of that is the end action that results from that work. And I think this whole concept of translation and how we move the information and the new ideas that we learn in our research arena into practice is probably one of the biggest challenges that we're going to be facing in this 21st century. So with that, I'm going to tell you a little bit about Allegheny County Health Department, certainly what I've learned in the last 6 months, and I have only 10 slides in 10 minutes, so more to come. This just tells you a little bit about Allegheny County Health Department for those who are not familiar with county health departments. Typically, we are in charge of a whole variety of public health functions, but honestly, if you've seen one health department, you've seen one health department. Allegheny has some of the most fundamental public health components. We do water, we do air, we do restaurants, and I can tell you that in Massachusetts that was not necessarily the case. So I think people understand a lot more about what public health does in this area than they might have in others. This is just our vision and our mission and a little bit about the county itself. This is the 30th largest county in the country. Even though Pittsburgh may not be considered one of the top 20 cities, the county itself is actually fairly large. And our diversity is changing. We also are the second oldest county in the United States, second only to Dade County, Miami. We used to be the first, so some changes. But that said, our county health rankings put us at number 46 out of 67. Philadelphia is 67, so we always like to compete with Philly. But that said, part of it is urban centers generally do have worse health indicators than other communities, but I got to tell you, we still have a lot of work to do. I want to mention just, I don't know if anyone has ever seen this, came out of the IOM, it's actually quite old, but for those of us in public health, this is sort of our mantra, this is the thing we put up on our walls. It talks about the 10 essential functions of public health and the three core functions that we really have to consider. And those are assurance, assessment, and policy development. There was a time when many health departments were doing a lot more clinical services than they're doing today. Philadelphia, for example, I think they have 7 community health centers. Multnomah County, Oregon has 12 community health centers. We don't have any community health centers. We maintain some clinical services in things like STDs and also in HIV and in tuberculosis. But other than that, most of our function around assurance is to make sure that people are getting the services they need by others in our communities. The assessment function is something that I'm hoping to build in Allegheny County. We have a bit of it, but not enough. And that means that our Bureau of Epidemiology and Biostats, which is likely to be one of the departments that you'll work heavily with if you decide that you want to do collaborative work with us, really needs to think about what our county looks like, what portions of our county look like, so that we can not only identify our baseline, but improvements or, unfortunately, things that get worse over time that we need to pay attention to. And in policy development, again, an area that we have not been as involved in as I would like to see, this is an area I'd like to see building. What are the policies that we can do as the one health regulatory body in the county to improve the health of our citizens without being Big Brother is watching you? So I wanted to just give you a little bit of data. There's a lot more of this, and this is just a taste to sort of give you some sense. One thing is that we know we have disparities by gender and by race. I would also argue by geography. There are portions of our county that have many more problems than other portions. And in particular, this shows you some information on African-American males, females, compared to others. And you can see that there's three areas in particular where we have disproportionate death in the African-American male population. So our infant mortality issues, our violence and homicide issues, and our premature death under the age of 65. But we've also got other issues that span the county, and while there are disparities, they affect all. One of them is obesity. We've got about 65% of the adult population that's either obese or overweight in Allegheny County, and on the child side, that's about 30%. We are still seeing too much cigarette smoking. I gotta say, one thing I really noticed just walking on the streets from Massachusetts was the difference in the number of people that are smoking here still. And I don't know if anybody has talked, and particularly for college populations, this entrance now of e-cigarettes is quite concerning to us in terms of what that's gonna mean and how those are used. And anybody wanna talk about medical marijuana? infant mortality, we've had some successes, but we still have work to do. And the same is true with our air. For those of you who are long-term Pittsburgh natives, you know that there's been tremendous gains in our air quality in this area, but we still are one of the worst counties in the country and have a lot of work to do. And that is a big piece of what we do in my department. So just in sort of pulling together what I've seen and learned in the first 6 months of my tenure here, some of our big areas of concern include our health equity issues. And as I mentioned, we have disparities that are geographic, that are related to race and ethnicity and also gender. And in particular, we have areas of our county, for example, areas around the Mon Valley, that really suffer disproportionately from a number of these issues. I'm very interested in physical activity and obesity. In some ways, that's a wonderful coalescing issue, something a lot of folks can get behind. And there's great interest in our county in focusing on these types of things. Health access. With the Affordable Care Act, we have an opportunity. That is, we can get people insured who have not been previously insured. 98,000 people in our county are identified as uninsured. We know that we've now, since the Affordable Care Act, about 124,000 in Pennsylvania have actually gotten insurance. But we don't have Medicaid expansion. And if there's anything that's really gonna turn the tide, it's really figuring out how that's gonna happen in our state. I did want to mention air and water, some big issues, obviously, as I mentioned, our air quality is improving, but we have big problems in stormwater, and there's going to be an ongoing conversation of how we address our crumbling, literally crumbling infrastructure with regard to stormwaters, which is now required by the EPA. So just to give you a flavor of some of the things that I've been involved in since I've gotten here, and every day is different. One of the things I would say for the students in the room, if you don't want to be bored, public health is a great career choice, because every day there will be something different, and as I said, you will not get bored. You may not always have the resources to deal with all of those issues, but with your friends, you hopefully can do that. So one of the things that, as I mentioned, is I really do want to build data capacity, both in epidemiology. I want to understand how we can use all of the new data elements that are coming out from claims data in our insurance companies and from the electronic health record in our delivery systems to influence public health. What are the differences between what we get from our self-assessment surveys and from those types of data sets? We are moving towards accreditation. There is now an external organization that accredits public health, and we need to be able to show that we are meeting all of those 10 essential functions. We don't have to do it ourselves. Sometimes that will be with our colleagues and our partners to get that job done. We recently launched a Live Well Allegheny campaign. You'll be hearing more about that. The bottom line is we want to really, from the top down, bottom up, sideways, to say that this is a county that should be one of the healthiest in the country, if not the healthiest, and all of the things that fit under that is something that we're focusing on. Initially, it's going to be mostly focused on overweight and on obesity and improving physical activity. Preventive care, I've mentioned one of my things is I'm ultimately a primary care doc, and I do believe that there is a lot of preventive care that we are now all entitled to. That's one of the great things about the Affordable Care Act, and for the first time, Medicare is actually going to pay for preventive visits. But are we getting people where they need to go? And I think that's something that we in public health can work with the delivery system and our community organizations to push forward. And the last thing I want to mention is, and you've probably heard in our county, we do have a big heroin problem. It's big. We're not the only county. Believe me, Massachusetts had a similar problem as well. And that's something that's become foremost on my plate without expecting it. You probably know that in a recent couple of weeks, we actually lost 17 people from overdose. So with that, I've given you at least an insight, hopefully, into what we're doing, what we're hoping to do. Lots more to come. Thank you so much for having me today.
Thank you so much, Dr. Hacker. I now would like to introduce our panelists. Before I do that, I had forgotten to mention that today's symposium is being videotaped to share the Healthy Campus conversation with students, staff, and faculty at our CMU campuses around the world. We understand that they, too, are launching some healthy initiatives, which we're very pleased about. Okay, so now I'd like to introduce our distinguished panel. Our first panelist is Dr. Baruch Fischhoff. He is the Howard Heinz University Professor of Social and Decision Sciences and Engineering and Public Policy at Dietrich College. Dr. Fischhoff, a world-renowned researcher on risk analysis, communication, and behavior, addresses how we understand and access health, safety, and environmental risk impacting ourselves and our communities. Across diverse contexts and cultures, Professor Fischhoff's research illuminates the process of decision-making on health. Following Dr. Fischhoff's presentation will be Professor Sheldon Cohen. We are all familiar with the phenomenon of getting sick during exam week or during other anxiety-laden times of our lives. Sheldon Cohen tells us why this happens. He studies stress, affect, and social support on immunity and susceptibility to infectious disease, including the common cold. Dr. Cohen is the Robert Daugherty Professor of Psychology at Dietrich College. Following Dr. Cohen, we have Rema Padman. Professor Padman is Professor of Management, Science, and Healthcare Informatics at the Heinz College. Professor Padman's research examines the capacities of today's information systems to inform and to improve health and wellness decision making for healthcare institutions as well as for ourselves. Her work includes the development of healthcare applications that enable users, especially the elderly, illiterate, and disadvantaged populations, to access healthcare information and tools. Lastly, Professor Kristen Kurland will take the podium. How does the design of cities, communities, and buildings affect health? Professor Kurland, who is the teaching professor of architecture, information systems, and public policy in both the School of Architecture and Heinz College, researches how changes to the built environment, physical design combined with social and economic development of communities, all result in healthy, sustainable places in which we all want to live. Using GPS technologies, city maps and health outcomes such as obesity rates and pedestrian injuries are connected, demonstrating how geography and urban design impact health. I have to say, our panel members are so accomplished, it was actually very difficult to be able to condense into a few sentences a summary of what they do. And so without further ado, I would like to introduce Professor Fischhoff to the podium. And after their individual presentations, they will sit here as a panel and be able to address your questions.
Thank you, Mary. Thank you, Dr. Suresh. And thank everybody who helped this to come. Thank you all for coming. So I'd like to give you a whirlwind tour through a line of research that I think typifies the kind of collaborative problem-focused research that goes on at the university, and I hope provides a piece of the puzzle for the topic of this symposium, which is namely how to get you the information that you need in order to make sound decisions about your own health. Like a lot of research, it begins with something that irritates you, and what continues to irritate us are poor health communications. So you've all seen things like this, patient package inserts, not designed to communicate to anybody, but they make the lawyers happy. Here's something, I was looking at the wrong slide. Okay, so here's something that is designed to communicate better, and actually it's not bad. This is the standard health communication for vaccines. If you reasonably literate, know English, and have the time, you can get a lot of what you need to know. You can't, however, find what are the numbers on the risks and the benefit of this, or why the CDC and its collaborators believe these numbers to be true. They have a story to tell, but they don't tell you the story if you're interested in making that decision. Here's another kind of communication. Here's a dietary supplement. This is saw palmetto. If you flip, you get some gist of the risks and benefits from looking at the bottle. If you turn it around, you get something useless like this. It does tell you, I discovered, it gives you the Latin name for pumpkin seed in case you've wanted to know that. Saw palmetto turns out to be one of the very few dietary supplements for which there is any research. You might legally put the grade text on the top saying that there's some vague correlation between this and prostate health, whatever that is. There's a court-mandated disclaimer on it, which tells you that this statement has not been evaluated by the Food and Drug Administration. It is not intended to diagnose, treat, cure, or prevent any disease. And go figure out what that means. Up until fairly recently, if you went to ready.gov, you would have found this bit of instruction on what to do in the event of a nuclear blast. So if, look at the panel in the middle, if there was a nuclear blast on the other end of the street, you're to turn the corner and run as fast as you can. So they flatter us. So how do you do better? So the approach that my colleagues and I from Decision Science bring is a pretty straightforward one. Listen to the decision makers. What do they know? What do they need to know? What are their objectives? What are the facts that the technical community has that could be relevant to them? How, draw on the basic science, all of the basic sciences, whatever you know, psychology, anthropology, sociology, in order to figure out how to deliver that information credibly. Draft something you think will work, evaluate it, and then try again until you have satisfied your duty to inform. So I'll show you very briefly some of the projects that we've been involved in. So this is a very general methodology. Here are some of the projects we've been involved in. You can only do this if you have collaborators, that is technical people who want your help and have access to the people who need that help so they can tell you how good a job you've done. Here's a screenshot from one of our projects. This is an interactive DVD that we developed here using actors from CFA and the University of Pittsburgh, designed to improve the sexual health of adolescents. There was a review several years ago that found that it was one of four programs over the preceding 20 years that had strong evidence improving the sexual health of young women. We now have a very large replication in the field. And in a completely different domain, this is a screenshot from Surging Seas. This is a website managed by Climate Central. This is a science-based organization located in Princeton that's designed to help people understand what the risks of climate change are from a variety of places, including sea level rise. By the time they got all the technical information, they had an impenetrable website. So my colleague Gabriel Wamparodi and Ben Strauss from there managed to get this to a website that people could then use. They delayed the launch by several months in order to make it as usable as possible. Here's in a completely different domain. Our health depends on the health of our planet. We've been working with a group of marine biologists organized through Conservation International and the University of California, Santa Barbara, funded by NCES, which might have been one of your, supported by you, trying to come up with a general health, an index for the health of the ocean. So like any index, like the one that Dr. Hacker was talking about, they require creating an index requires expert judgment in order to render the facts into a form that people can that will address your practical needs, and it also requires value judgments in terms of what it is that you have that you consider important in nature. Is preserving artisanal fisheries important to you? Are jobs important to you? Is the health of the zoonotic diseases important to you? So we've worked with them in developing it. If we want, imagine that we have better ways of getting information out to people, do we have the institutional mechanisms for making that translation? So we're fortunate to have a Food and Drug Administration that both in the latter years of the Bush administration and in the Obama administration has been very forceful in trying to improve its communication. It has, since 2009, has had a strategic plan for risk communication, which you can download. It has a risk communication advisory committee that I was honored to chair through its first few years, and each of our meetings began with FDA staff telling us how they were working, making progress on implementing their plan. It's produced a guide to communicating risks and benefits that's designed to make the science available to anybody, free download if anybody wants. FDA currently has a nationwide listening campaign trying to find out from people in affected communities what it is that they want FDA to weigh when they consider, when they make decisions about whether drugs should be made available to consumers. If you're interested, they just posted a fascinating set of webcasts having to do with sickle cell disease. If you just go to FDA and look at it, it's very moving. Start at minute 50 of webcast one and hear how grateful people are to be listened to and how attentive the FDA staff is. FDA has also committed to, I can't read this, but to a benefit risk framework that will make explicit to the general public, to the pharmaceutical industry, the bases of its decisions. That is, what it considers to be the evidence, what it considers to be the uncertainties associated with them, and what are the interpretations within the constraints of their enabling legislation that lead it to the decisions that it makes. One thing that FDA has not been able to do is to improve the packaging on the labels. It just turns out to be too difficult from regulatory purposes. So for a while, FDA was considering creating a drug fact box, which is an example seen here, developed by the Medical Outcomes Group at the VA and Dartmouth Medical School, with whom we've collaborated some over the years. And they have found that if you do a good job of presenting quantitative information about the risk and about the benefits and about the quality of the information, that most patients from a representative sample of Americans are able to extract the information that they need. So people will claim that the public is innumerate and scientifically illiterate. If you do a good job, people can understand it. So they have money from Robert Wood Johnson to make these available to the public general. They'll be starting to roll them out sometime later this year. So as I mentioned, it's important to get all the science that you can available here. So I've been fortunate enough to help to co-organize two Sackler colloquia at the National Academy of Sciences on the sciences of science communication, each of which will have a special issue of the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. One of them is out. Another one will be, this came out a few months ago. We had a second colloquium this year. There were webcasts there, and we've brought people who had something to contribute. So we had Dave Clark, who many of you will know from our psych department, spoke about science education and what we know about the developmental processes whereby people learn to understand science. So why is this work done at Carnegie Mellon? Of course, not the only place. I think this the initiative we have typifies three things that we do here. One is that we're committed to problems, and second is that there's a collaborative ethos. And the third, that we believe that basic science arrives from application. So you can advance the science at the same time as you're trying to help people. So thank you.
Thank you, Professor Fischhoff. And I'd now like to introduce Professor Sheldon Cohen.
Thank you, Mary. I'm going to talk a little about some of the work we've done over the last 30 years on the role of stress and disease. And we're going to start by defining stress. So psychologists define stress as your perception that your demands exceed your ability to cope. Okay? So we have two questions in mind. One is, how could stress get inside the body to influence disease processes? And the other one is, what kinds of stressors matter? Under what conditions does stress influence your health and well-being? Okay, so we start out with this hypothesis that psychological stress is going to put us at greater risk for disease. And we're particularly interested in infectious disease, immune-related diseases. So the simple idea is that stress influences the immune system in some way that makes us more susceptible, more likely to get sick when we're exposed to an infectious agent. Now, there are really kind of two major pathways through which this could occur. So the bottom pathway, health practices, we know under stress, people smoke more, they drink more, they don't exercise as much, they have poorer diets, they don't sleep as well. All of these things are known to alter immune function. On the top hormones, there are some hormones that are generally affected by stressful situations. So under stress, we get increases in sympathetic nervous system hormones, epinephrine and norepinephrine. We get increases in the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal cortical axis hormone, cortisol. So you read about this in the paper all the time. These hormones can affect the immune system. Lymphocytes, the major cell in the immune system, have receptors for these hormones. They interact with them, and they can regulate immune function. So that's how it could happen. I'm going to tell you about some work we've been doing for about 35 years now on the common cold, specifically looking at the question, can does stress put people at risk for a cold when they're exposed to a virus, okay? We're exposed to viruses every day of our lives. We don't always get sick, okay? We don't get sick because our immune system acts and protects us from the infectious agent. So this is the basic design of our studies. We take healthy people who are in the age range of about 18 to 55, and we measure psychological stress in them, and I'll describe that in a second. Then we expose them to a virus that causes the common cold. We follow them for 5 or 6 days in quarantine, and we see if they develop an illness, okay? We measure a number of control factors in all these studies: age, sex, education, body mass index, the season of the year, the virus we expose them to, and their current immunity to the virus, whether they have or how much antibody they have to the specific virus at the beginning of the study. So the simple question is, when you take healthy people, you measure their stress level, you expose them to a virus, who gets sick and who doesn't get sick, okay? Roughly a third of the people we expose to viruses get sick, okay? So the question here is, will stress predict who gets sick and who doesn't? So this is how we expose people to viruses. She gets a drop in each nose with a controlled number of viral particles. The outcome in the study that is having a cold is defined in two ways. One is you have to be infected by the virus that we give you, and infected means that the virus takes over the cell mechanism and replicates itself, so the virus is replicating. And the other is that you show objective signs of the illness. Okay, and we look at two objective measures. We don't just we actually ask people about their symptoms too, but we're mostly concerned with these objective signs. One is how much mucus they produce. So we actually, every time they use a tissue, they put it in a bag, they tie it up, we weigh it, subtract the bag and the tissue, and we get their mucus weights. The other one is mucociliary clearance function, and that's an objective measure of how congested they are. So to have a cold, they have to be infected, the virus has to be replicating, and they have to have the symptoms, okay? Is stress associated with increased susceptibility to the common cold? First study we did, we used self-report questionnaires about stress, basically asking, do your demands exceed your ability to cope? Are there major stressful life events in your life? Then we expose them to the virus, and this is what we found. So with every increase on the stress measure, there is an increase in the probability that they're going to get a cold. The second study we were interested in, does the duration of the stressful event matter? The first study, we measured stress in a very kind of loose way, in a sense, where we didn't know about particular stressors or anything about them. So in this study, we actually do detailed interviews about the stressor, so we can get, among other things, how long the stressor lasts. So measure stress, expose them to the virus, here's what happens. So this is the number of months that their longest stressor had lasted. And as you can see from the slide, people who had stressors lasting 24 months or more were roughly 4 times as likely to get a cold as people who had no stressors at all. And you can see as the duration of the stressor increases, the probability they'll get a cold when we expose them to a virus increases. Using the same technique, that is the interview technique, we also ask what type of stressful events matter, okay? And we expose them to the virus, and basically we find that there are two kinds of events that really matter. Now, these are all now events that last 1 month or longer, okay? One is work events. Work events turn out to be unemployment and underemployment. Underemployment is having a job that's not commensurate with your training and background, okay? So people with this work stress were about 5 times more likely to get sick. I want to focus a little more on the interpersonal stress. So interpersonal stressors are ongoing conflicts. They can be conflicts at work, they can be conflicts, marital conflicts, conflicts with friends that are lasting a month or longer, and people who had those kinds of stressors were roughly 3 times more likely to get sick than people with no stressor at all. Okay. So I'm going to turn this around. We just found that having social conflicts, interpersonal conflicts, are bad for you. Most of us think of our social ties as being good for you, so I wanted to show you the other side. So can our social ties improve our health? And here we look at a very specific measure of social ties. It's called network diversity or social integration, and it looks at how diverse your social network is. So basically, you answer questions as follows. Are you a spouse, partner, parent, child, child-in-law, close relative? And for each one, you say whether you interact with people in this role at least once a month by telephone or in person. So if you say you're a child, but you never talk to your parents, you don't get credit for being a child, okay? So all we do is count the number of social roles that they endorse, and then expose them to the virus, who gets sick. Okay, so the people with the fewest number of social roles, the most constrained social network, are about four times more likely to get sick than people with six or more social roles. And again, you can see this is a graded kind of relationship. The more diverse your network, the more protected you are from getting a cold. Okay, so in sum, we found that chronic enduring stressful events put you at risk for colds, that un and underemployment have potent negative effects on health, interpersonal stressful events have potent negative effects on health, and that diverse social networks can protect us from infection.
Thank you, Professor Cohen. And next, I'd like to introduce Professor Rema Padman.
Thank you, Mrs. Suresh, and thank you for inviting me to participate on this panel. We hear a lot these days about shared decision-making, about personalized healthcare, and patient-centered care. But when we try to tie this to health and wellness, I see what I like to call a big consumability challenge. I think Baruch addressed this via talking about risk communication, how to communicate risk information. And so this idea is not new. We've had a lot of thinking and work on the consumability challenge. So what is it? More than 40 years ago, CMU's own Herb Simon talked about consumability challenge, saying that in an information-rich world, the wealth of information means a dearth of something else, a scarcity of whatever it is that information consumes. So what does information consume? It consumes the attention of its recipients. And so really, a wealth of information creates a poverty of attention and a need to allocate that attention efficiently among the overabundance of information sources that consume it. And I think this is exactly one of the challenges that we are facing in healthcare. So if you think about the consumability challenge in healthcare, we are, moving fast. It's a fast-moving digitization of healthcare that we are going through at the current time. So what we are creating are really data-rich but analytics-poor healthcare environment. Just to give you a couple of examples, it's predicted that this year, in 2014, 90 million wearable devices will be shipped. These are things on our wristbands and body media sensors and checking your calorie counters and sleep habits. And so wearable devices, 90 million, that's almost a third of the population. At the same time, we are deploying all these electronic health records and clinical information systems with both genomic information and clinical information. And the estimate is that there'll be about 5 to 10 gigabytes of data on every individual whose information is captured in these systems. So you're talking about an explosion in digital information. And when we think about how this information is actually accessible, but how can we use it to provide cognitively guided decision support at the point of decision making? That's really the challenge. That's what I like to think of as a consumability challenge. So the question that we are asking, so I'd like to show, illustrate this in the context of an example, risk assessment, but using visualization. And so the question that we are asking is, how can we make all this data consumable and support shared decision making, personalized care, and make it all patient-centered? And the one of the approaches that we are trying is, we need mechanisms, methods to synthesize the data. Dr. Hacker talked about some of those challenges here in the county. How do we really develop methods and approaches to summarize the data, to contextualize it, but because the type of decision I need to make could change depending upon the context, and then can we visualize it to make it more consumable? And so let me illustrate it in the context of assessing the risk of heart attack in patients with diabetes. Why is this important? Well, if you look at, there was a recent study reported about a study done by an insurance organization looking at the cost of risk factors per employee in the organization. And as you see here, we see that the cost of high blood pressure, so high blood pressure is a risk factor, obesity is a risk factor, elevated cholesterol is a risk factor, and so on. And the cost of each of those you see represented there for that population. And if the interventions are applied and if the consumers understand these risks, it's communicated very well, the right actions are taken, then the potential cost savings you see are in the thousands of dollars. And so this is again an estimate that was created for that population. Tracking, you know, providing the right medications and so on for a year, and over $30,000 to $60,000 of cost savings per year. So how is this information provided at the current time? A lot of it is provided in the clinical systems via these kinds of spreadsheets. It's many different variables, many different patients, and a patient comes in, and you have to make the right decision at the right time in those few minutes that are available. And there's really no shared decision-making facility at that time. So what we have, working with colleagues and students at the Heinz College, we have developed both methodologies and tools to make this communication a lot easier. And the proposed method that we have is to be able to analyze many patients, many risk factors at the population level, at the patient level, and at the intervention level. So what we see here in this graph, I don't know how well you can see to the back there, but we see the distribution of risk in the population. So if we ignore these, what we call these risk factor anchors, we see the distribution of risk in the population. So those at high risk are the red dots. Those at low risk are the green dots. So we take those multidimensional information, reduce it down to two dimensions, visualize the risk for these individual patients at the population level, but we need to contextualize it. And we contextualize it using, by anchoring these risk factors, using the same methods to be able to interpret, to identify which are the most significant risk factors for this population to predict heart attack in this population with diabetes. So what we see here are risk factors like high LDL, family history of cardiovascular disease are really significant in this population. And patients who are compliant with their aspirin medication or have high HDL, it acts as protective factors and pull the population toward that lower risk region. So at the population level, now you're able to see the distribution of risk in the population and see which are the factors that are really significant. But we can take it a step further to look at how do you really look at what impact it has on a particular patient. And applying the same idea, you click on a patient, so what we have here is a specific patient at a level of risk that is actually driven now not by all of those risk factors that we saw at the population level, but rather the specific drivers of risk for this patient are really that the patient has high systolic blood pressure and has high blood sugar level. And you see that information also represented at the detailed values and comparison with the major thresholds, the important parameters that are being followed for that population. We can look at another patient at the same level of risk. So here is a patient at the same level of risk, but the drivers of risk are now different. For this patient, the drivers of risk are the smoker and high LDL. So we are able to now, this is the idea of personalization. That is, at the population level, you see what are the significant risk factors of the population. At the individual patient level, you see the individual drivers of risk. Then we can ask, for this patient, it's very clear that the cholesterol levels, it's elevated cholesterol, and the, what the intervention ought to be. So now we can also ask the question, well, if that intervention is applied, and the patient is compliant with that medication for the right intervals, let's say for appropriate duration, how much will the risk reduce? And so we can also look at the effect of interventions. And so what we see here is that this patient's risk can actually reduce from this point to a much lower level if the patient is compliant with that intervention. And so this becomes, this is really where patients can look at this information and look at the impact and the significance of that action and perhaps have that conversation with their clinicians, their care team, to really be able to act on that. So this, we believe, it really complements the information that's available in the clinical systems, the engagement that we're having with our providers and the care team, as well as the community, to be able to look at it and say, what are the interventions at the population level that are really going to be more significant and cost-effective and better outcomes, but also at the population level that is data-driven, it's evidence-based, it's looking at many patients, as I said, many variables, and at multiple levels of interventions. So we are currently looking at working with five different organizations to evaluate the effectiveness of these methods in actual usage settings. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Padman. And lastly, we have Professor Kurland, after which the panel will assemble here. And please be sure to get your questions written down and distributed to the people at the ends of the aisles. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. So I have an important announcement to make before I begin. Team Canada is winning 1-0 at the end of the second period, but not to worry. Our guys will come back and win. I have a lot of bets on that. So I want to talk a little bit about how Carnegie Mellon works within different organizations and how we affect the community. And my work is interdisciplinary, very much within Carnegie Mellon. So I'm a joint appointment between the School of Architecture and the Heinz College. I also teach in our Civil and Environmental Engineering School. And I do a lot of work with our campuses, both in Adelaide and in Doha. And also, if you look at the, I have to go here, one more here. If you look at the bubble on the right, these are the different organizations that I have worked with related to health. So there's a wide variety of people that have been participating with me in a lot of these projects. What I do is I do spatial mapping, and I look at the geography of health. And one of the reasons, one of the ways I got involved in this was I was writing a book, a workbook on teaching people about how GIS, geographic information systems, can address different health issues. And so Allegheny County Health Department has actually been one of my collaborators, and I'll talk at the end about some of those projects. But I wanted to give you a flavor of the different kinds of projects that I've worked on. The first project is related to childhood obesity, and I started this work back in 2004. This was before a lot of people were starting to look at this problem. And I went to Children's Hospital of Pittsburgh as I was writing this book, and I said, could we look at mapping your patients and start to look at this from a perspective of city planning? And they said they've never heard of this. Nobody had done this before. There hadn't been architects involved in this process. And they were intrigued by this. And it just so happened that Children's Hospital has something called the Weight Management Wellness Center, which was funded by the Department of Defense. Everybody kind of scratches their head when I say that that was the funder. It was actually the late John Murtha, congressman from the middle of the state, who got that funding. And he established a center here in Pittsburgh for obesity, and we also have a duplicate one at Lackland Air Force Base in San Antonio. So what I did here was I worked with the center to look at kids who and their obesity progress over time, or lack of progress. So you're looking at a map here that shows what's called a BMI Z-score. And a negative number means that a kid has actually lost weight, so that's a positive. And a positive number here means that a kid has a positive Z-score, which means that that kid has gained weight. And what I did was I took this and I mapped where those kids lived, and then I created these buffers around parks and also looked at their proximity to fast food. And so from the analysis, one of the things that we found was that patients that lived within 1,200 feet of a park, about half of those who got better lived within the park, so about 43%, almost half. And then but the interesting thing was 83% of the kids who got worse, who had an increase in BMI, lived further away from a park. So the idea here, and also the kids that lost weight lived a little bit further away from fast food, and the kids that gained weight lived a little closer. The idea here was just an exploratory study. And one of the things we wanted to do is see, of these kids, what was the relationship to these green spaces? So if you look at this kid here, the kid that lost weight had a pretty easy access to the park, and there were a lot of amenities when that kid got to the park. So the researchers and the physicians and the social workers could sit down and have a conversation with these kids and say, look, if you can get some physical activity in throughout the day, you know, this will be good for you. And it's consistent physical activity that they were looking at. We looked at a patient who actually gained weight and saw that not only when this kid has a little bit harder time getting to the park, but more so when that kid gets to the park, it's just a bunch of wooded area. So when we start to look at these studies, a lot of researchers do these kinds of studies. You live near a park. Well, our city planning department considers an urban boulevard a park because they have to mow it with grass. You have to see what is the park. We don't encourage kids to play in urban boulevards, by the way. Karen and I were talking earlier, and I completely agree with her. We do this research, but we don't do it just for research sake. We really have to make an impact on what we're doing. The other thing that I've worked on with Children's Hospital Pittsburgh are pedestrian injuries. So this was a study that I did with the trauma surgeons and the trauma doctors in the emergency department. And the one flaw with this project was that we didn't have a complete set of where all injuries happened. These were kids that had severe injuries under the age of 14, and we only had a database from Children's Hospital to look at. But one of the things we were looking at here was the green space again. One of our hypotheses was that kids who live closer at a park would be less injured because they were playing in those parks. They weren't playing in the streets near vehicle access. And one of the things that we did find here was that, in fact, it wasn't significant, but kids that had higher injuries, the green space density was a little bit lower in most of those neighborhoods. And you'll see here, we also looked at where the kids lived, and again, their proximity to the park. So once again, we saw that kids who actually did live much closer to the park had fewer injuries. And lastly, we wanted to look at poverty. We looked at things like single moms, and we wanted to know that were kids that were in these areas of high poverty more prone to injuries, and we did find that that, in fact, was so. So what do we do with this? Well, one of the things we did was we went to city planning, and we said, there's an indication that kids who live closer to parks and green space, in fact, are healthier. We have kids that are losing weight. We have kids that are being less injured. And that really hit home with the city planning department and the mayor's office. And they did a lot of other studies, and we've done some additional Heinz College studies looking at parks in the green space. And this map just shows the population around parks. So this would help them prioritize which parks they may want to concentrate on if they were going to be doing some improvements in that area. I also worked with the Pittsburgh Public Schools, who were looking at a study to see if we don't have the access within a building to take kids and get exercise, which is true. Many of our schools don't have the infrastructure to be able to do healthy activity within the schools. Could we get a kid to a park and have them have some physical activity there as well? So these are just some of those maps and those projects. If you're interested in your walkability, there's a great website called walkscore.com. You can type in your address and find out the walkability, meaning what amenities do we have here, how easy is it to walk in your neighborhood. I just wanted to talk about a few other projects. This is one that is for the food bank, the Greater Pittsburgh Community Food Bank. They came to us and said, on this theme of healthy food and access to food, are our centers where we distribute food in places where we need it? So one of the things that one of my Heinz College students did was looked at the map here. The black dots are these areas of distribution. So these are schools and churches and different centers that distribute food from the food bank. And we did an analysis looking at census data on poverty and people who were in need of this service. And we combined many different variables together to create what's called a heat map or a hotspot map. And we were then able to overlay those two sets of data. And we created this nice index for the food bank to say, here are the organizations that are serving these areas of need, and there are gaps. There are other areas in the city where we potentially might want to have areas to serve. I mentioned briefly Allegheny County, the health department. The book that I've written is called GIS Tutorial for Health. It's a book that I teach and use in our Heinz College Health GIS class. And there were the interesting thing about this one was there was a capacity building grant with the Centers for Disease Control. And they basically wanted to have the organization collaborate more together. And so the five different groups were lead, food, water, air, and housing. And they wanted them to be able to basically talk to each other and explore ways that they could collaborate. And so I met with them over many, many meetings over a couple of years, and explaining how this tool, this mapping tool, could be used to look at all of these different scenarios that they have. And so the result of that, one of the ones that ended up getting into the book was one looking at kids with lead poisoning. And we were able to take all of these cases of kids over a five-year period. And I should say that for those of you that know anything about healthcare, we had to aggregate this data because you obviously can't have the individual location of where these kids are located. So we aggregated the data to census block groups, and we then looked at things like the age of the housing where the kid lives. And so we were able to see that is there a correlation between old homes where we had lead paint in homes and kids who had lead poisoning. We also then used some of their own data. We looked at housing complaint data, and we looked at the correlation between where we have complaints in public housing and kids who had lead poisoning, as well as just, again, general demographic data about lead poisoning. So this just gives you a flavor of the kinds of work that I do, and again, one of the things that I always say is that I want to have an impact. So every time a researcher or somebody from one of the medical institutions comes to me, I say, okay, we'll do this project, but then what can we do to have an effect on this? And I should tell you a couple of things. With the pedestrian injury project, one of the things we realized was that we did not have a great data set. So we marched down to Councilman Bill Peduto's office and said, here's our problem. Can you help us out with this? And he said, yeah. And by the way, we found out that PennDOT had the database that we wanted because they actually had where all the accidents happened. They were a little reluctant to give it to us because they didn't know that if we identified these areas of the county where we had problems, could they possibly be sued? Would there be a problem? And Bill Peduto said, you know, I was actually hit by a car once downtown. I'm going to get that data set for you. And so sometimes you have to leverage the political collaboration there too. And the other thing I just want to end with here, and by the way, these are some other projects. We do a lot with Children's Hospital. I've done some stuff talking about collaborations. The project with the Central Blood Bank was a follow-up to Rema's systems project, where she had students working with them. And I do a lot of work with the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center, a lot of physicians. connect and collaborate is not my term. It's from the dean of the Heinz College, Krishnan. It really fosters this collaboration within our school and tells us to go out and collaborate. One last thing, you never know who is going to pop up in your email to ask you about collaborations. Some of you have heard this story, but it's an interesting story related to my childhood obesity. One day I woke up, and I have about 50 or so emails each morning when I wake up, and I kind of go through them and see the priority. And there was one by the guy by the name of Sam Cass, which I didn't recognize at all. And the heading was, "Hi, can we talk?" And I almost deleted it, but I said I didn't have time. I actually went on and went about my day, and I came back, and one of my Heinz students, former Heinz student, said, "Heads up, the White House chef is going to be emailing you this morning. His name is Sam Cass." Turns out Sam Cass is Michelle Obama's personal chef and the head of all of her Let's Move White House initiatives. That was back in 2007 when he contacted me. I didn't know who he was at the time. So don't delete your emails if you don't know who that is. Save them and make sure you know who it is. So anyway, I want to thank you all, and hopefully if you find yourselves out there, make sure you connect and collaborate. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Kurland, and we are running a little bit over time, but I am hoping that many of you will be able to stay, and I certainly appreciate your taking the time out today from your class or your work or your teaching. Thank you very much. So our panelists are now ready to field some questions, so I'll begin. What is the number one risk to our health at this time? Is it stress? Is it obesity? If one could address one risk, what would it be?
I'm going to let Sheldon answer that.
I don't know. Certainly obesity is a major risk. Is stress a major risk to our health? It depends what you mean by address it as part of the problem. So if you're talking about at a public policy level or an institutional level or an individual level, I think at least from the alternatives we've been given, I think obesity would be a major public policy risk at this time. But it's just an opinion. So,
yeah. Perhaps from a decision-making perspective, you might ask, well, where have we underinvested, and where could money go the furthest? So my wife works on child abuse and neglect. I think that would be a really high priority area.
I think from a personalized care perspective, I would say that it's important for us to identify subpopulations with obesity could be in one group, stress could be in another. As we are learning from our research, there is a lot to be gained by doing a little bit more personalization and understanding the risk factors that drive these types of poor outcomes in different segments of the population.
Yeah, I don't think it's easy to say that any one of these is, because it all depends on who you are and where you are as well. And I think one key thing, too, is access to healthcare. And I think that's a big issue, no matter what the problem is you're looking at. And that's one thing that we always try to look at and see, whether it's mental health, physical health, what are the resources out there to help people?
Thank you. The next question. As innovators and leaders of cultural change, it seems we at CMU are ethically called to anticipate potential negative consequences of our innovations and work to minimize negative health impacts by educating users and including mindfulness of unanticipated negative consequences. In project planning and implementation, do we do this, and if not, why? Any thoughts on that? Do you want me to repeat the question? I think the question is getting at anticipating negative consequences of innovations that we may implement, and I guess the question is basically, do we try to anticipate negative health impacts? I think maybe that has more to do with risk, I would think, Professor Fischhoff.
who is we? I mean, I suspect that all of us try to do it. I would say the kind of work that we do we try to listen to people. I mean, I can only speak for myself. We try to listen to people. We try to empower them. We try to avoid manipulating them wherever possible, and you know, do the best we can.
Thank you.
Yeah, you know, President Suresh mentioned the unintended consequences, both of some of these innovations, the new ideas, the methods that we propose, the technologies that we put in. And I think we need to probably develop a culture that allows us to both report these unintended consequences and then to be able to act on them in sensitive ways. I think that's a step that we need to think about and develop some solutions, approaches for.
Well, and if you talk about innovations, and you know, I come at this also from an architecture perspective. You know, one of the problems that we had with our nation and how we designed was that we started to have these neighborhoods. You know, it used to be that we were concentrated in cities, and then as designers and architects, we said, "Oh, we're moving to the suburbs. We're developing these great developments." And that was actually a negative thing then. We ended up having these areas where we didn't have walkability and we didn't have that connection with neighborhoods. And so you could look at that maybe even with today's technology innovations. People are becoming more isolated. They're just looking at their own devices and they're not talking as much to each other. So I think you have to be careful with a lot of these innovations that are happening and how that affects the human-to-human interactions as well.
Yeah, the answer is obviously yes, we need to be careful, but I can give you one example. And with my colleague Vicki Helgeson, we did some social support interventions for cancer patients a number of years ago for women with breast cancer. And one of the major foci of the project was identifying people and or conditions where the social support interventions might have negative effects. So is it better for people who have strong interpersonal relationships in their social networks and versus people who have weak networks? Does it matter what stage of cancer they have? Does it matter what their personalities are? And so certainly we're really sensitive to the issues of kind of targeting an intervention for the person to the positive side as opposed to the negative side. So.
Thank you. And in line with that, what do you feel is the best way to address stress culture in a university setting?
So in healthcare, we talk about creating a learning healthcare system, a system that has feedback loops that allow, as in the case of unintended consequences, to learn about from the errors. You know, they're called unintended consequences because we're not able to anticipate what are all the poor effects associated with those interventions. So to be able to then collect them, to be able to study them, to be able to analyze them, to be able to develop good solutions for them, and then to feed them back into the system. So creating a learning environment, learning healthcare system, has really become a big focus of the whole health reform process. And I think we could try to apply that same idea to all of the unintended consequences that arise in other situations as well.
I would say if you look at it within the university setting, one of the things that I always tell my students is, and we say this with eating, you know, balance everything. And I know it's hard to say sometimes because, you know, I work almost every weekend and I work a lot, but also prioritize. And I think that a lot of times we feel like we have to say yes to everything. And I know that there are times where I have to say no. I have so many projects where people want me to do this, then I have to say, okay, I just can't do that. So I think, you know, in the university setting too, for us as faculty and staff and students, you know, being able to have somewhat of that balance, even though we are a driven organization, to have that somewhat the priority set, I think. Was that, that was the question right
about yes, the university? Yes, yes, thank you, another question for you. We think of decisions about our health, what we eat, how often we exercise, as acts of individual choice and free will. Each of you has shown in your research that choices are heavily shaped by our environment, by how information is presented on the nature of our jobs or our neighborhoods. How much responsibility for healthy choices do we really have, given environmental concerns?
You're going to give us a scale, 0 to 5? I don't know that answer. It depends on the situation and the context. And I think the important issue is the question itself, that there are environmental and social and factors that have a major impact on people's health behaviors. And that interacts with their own predispositions and motivations as well. You know, how much each is weighed just depends on the particular situation.
Yeah. But maybe the subtext there is that we should be careful about faulting people for failing to do the impossible. So if they don't have access to food or parks, then we ought to reduce our criticism for their failure to exercise, and if we give them incomprehensible health information, then we're not, it's just not fair.
Thank you. And we have time for one last question. Okay. Just moving slightly away from our campus, thinking about how much travel we all do intercontinentally. And this, of course, has raised the threat of infectious disease. Over the past decade, we've seen serious scares about SARS and different strains of flu. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention announced just this week that H1N1 is continuing to strike and kill people under 65 this year in great numbers. And I think I can plug the fact that it's not too late to get a flu shot if you haven't done so, and it's highly recommended. Another deadly flu strain has been discovered in China. Can you comment on how your research could suggest better ways to prepare for such epidemics and expand our understanding of them among the most vulnerable among us?
I see my research as using the data and to build evidence to perhaps facilitate actionable, to provide actionable information. So as I said, as the solutions that we propose or the approach that we propose for building these solutions to provide this cognitively guided decision-making capability is we need access to, we need to collect all this information, we need to synthesize them, we need to summarize them, we need to analyze and contextualize, you know, what is the decision that's being made at that time, and then to be able to present it in ways that for different decision makers at different points in time, answering different kinds of questions in different ways, so that we can all act in, you know, there's a coherent action that can be taken to solve, address these types of complex issues. So help to break them down by using data to understand what is going on. So that's really the perspective that I would bring to this type of a complex situation.
I would say that also this collaboration between us that do data analysis at the university with healthcare providers. One of the big things that I've found is this buy-in from the hospitals, the physicians, and then also I think real time too. One of the things that I wasn't able to show was some of the apps now that look at outbreaks. Where are they happening, but then how can we proactively have resources for them? And there's a lot of interesting things going on. There's a project where we're looking at pharmacies and even the purchase of, you know, flu medicines, and we're seeing that can we identify areas where we have some of these epidemics happening. And so I think, you know, working together cross-disciplinary with these teams of people to, again, not only identify that there is a problem, but then what is the course of action to help with that?
So, well, I think the closest we can get is that work in identifying vulnerable populations. So we know that people low in social economic status, people who are isolated and lonely, people who are in chronically stressful work conditions are all at greater risk for developing illness given these kinds of infections. So it might allow us some leeway in focusing where to try to put our resources.
So if one does all of this, I would advocate for having the medical community doing a better job of communicating what they know in a way that gets and retains the trust of the public. Sheldon and I went to the same high school, Detroit Mumford, and somebody else who went there, like a friend named Larry Brilliant, organized a meeting at the onset of the avian, what looked like the avian flu pandemic, and we helped him to organize the meeting and did a survey of some of the leading public health people who Larry got there and some leading media and Silicon Valley people who he thought might keep the society going if we were all hunkered down and quarantined. And we did a survey. We asked the public health people what they thought the probability of transmissible flu was, and they thought it was about a 10%. They expected a 15% case fatality rate, so that would get your attention at a 10%, right? And we asked the most sophisticated group of lay people you could imagine what they thought the probability was, and they thought it was 60%. So if you didn't have a pen, if you thought that the experts were saying 60% and you didn't get it, and then you didn't get it with swine flu, then you begin to wonder what they're saying. These are things that people can understand if we're willing to communicate in a professional and scientific way.
Well, thank you. I really would like to thank our panelists for joining us today. And I want to add, I think this is the beginning of many discussions that we'll be having around campus on topics of all kinds involving health and wellness. We have a wealth of resources here at CMU, starting, you know, with research and also continuing on with all kinds of resources that students and staff and faculty can avail themselves of. So I thank you so much for taking the time to inform us of your
and,
work.
And this is a springboard for ongoing events, as I mentioned. So please be sure you check the new Healthy Campus website, which is quite beautiful and informative, to just make sure that you know what's coming up and join us for events that are coming up in the coming months. So thank you.
Mary,
thank you so very much.
Yes.
Thank you all for being here.
And Mary, thank you on behalf of the piano. Thank you for everything.
Thank you.